Joined on the phone today by author Stephen J. Rubin. We're talking about his new book, The Twilight Zone Encyclopedia. Hey, Stephen, how are you today?
Oh, I'm great. Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining me. I'm excited about your new book.
Well, I had a lot of fun writing it. I mean, I'll tell you, I spent 2 years writing the complete James Bond encyclopedia, and that was covering 22 films. Writing in the Twilight Zone encyclopedia required watching 156 episodes of the show very, very carefully, and it took me a lot longer because I'm a bit of a completist. I need to have information on literally everything. So it took me 3 years, and I think the book reflects a lot of the fun of the show, and it dials deep into the backgrounds of so many people and gives you as much behind-the-scenes information as I can.
Yeah, it's wonderful that someone finally has made a book like this happen, The Twilight Zone Encyclopedia. And as you mentioned, it's kind of like two books in a way, an episode guide, but then you really go behind the scenes and look at everything and everyone involved in the show.
You know, it was such an iconic show, and it's generational. People embrace it. You know, it's hard to get teenagers today to watch black and white. It's just, I have my own kids who really don't look at black and white, but my teenage son, he ended up watching some episodes and got hooked. And I think it's because the Twilight Zone not only gives you an entertaining story, but it tells you about something of the human condition. And that was Rod's intent. Rod Serling was a very frustrated writer. He had won 3 Emmys in live television, but they wouldn't allow him to tell the stories he really wanted to tell. Controversy did not belong on television at that time, according to the executives. He always wanted to tell the Emmett Till story, that horrifying story of the African-American teenager who whistled at a white woman and was hung. And they said, okay, you can tell this story, Rod, but you got to make him a Mexican. And it was so horrific for him to hear things like that. There was one story that may be apocryphal, but they said if you're doing a cavalry western and the troops are about to cross the river, and the show was being sponsored by Chevrolet, you could not have the commander say, we're going to ford that river. I mean, those kind of stupid, inane, sponsor-driven comments were just something he couldn't deal with anymore. So when live television died, he came west where they were doing film television, and then, of course, he sold The Twilight Zone.
Well, it's almost 60 years ago the show debuted, but not only does it hold up, and it still seems to be better than almost everything that came after it. It's amazing that it's still probably the best written show on TV.
Not only the best written show, but I would say the best performed show. That one of the hallmarks of my book, I hope, is that I give names to many of the faces that you recognize from the show. But, you know, obviously there were the Robert Redfords and the Charles Bronsons and the James Coburns and the Burt Reynolds, and, of course, they were starting out in their career. But what are the people who got leads that you didn't know, like John Anderson? John Anderson, major character actor, was in 4 episodes. He played the commander of the jet that goes through time in the Odyssey of Flight 33. He's Gabriel the Angel in A Passage for Trumpet. But we need to know more about his background. Who are these people and what did they bring? You discover that many of them worked in live television with a lot of the same actors. So they were experienced, some of the directors they worked with. And these people need to be honored by history. They should not be forgotten. And The Twilight Zone gave leading parts to these guys who were always kind of second bananas. So it was an extraordinary opportunity for them. I had fun getting in touch with a lot of them. A lot of them were still living. A lot of them just through their families to get photographs. And I really pride myself on the photographs I have in the book because a lot of them are very rare. Carol Serling, Rod's widow, was very helpful. She gave me the contract so I could tell you how much people made in those days, which was such a pittance. So I'm giving you information that's not available in the other Twilight Zone books. And I'm not a critic. I'm not going to criticize the episode. I'm going to let you decide for yourself. And I'm also not going to give you the whole synopsis. I'm giving you what I call the setup. So you know what the show's about, but you're not going to get a spoiler. And I think it gives you the opportunity to share it with new generations.
Definitely. Again, Stephen J. Rubin with us today and talking about his book, The Twilight Zone Encyclopedia. You know, if you haven't seen many of the episodes, it's amazing how quickly you start noticing when you watch them, how many other shows and films over the years really kind of lifted a lot of ideas from The Twilight Zone.
Very good point. In fact, I make the point in some of my interviews that every single filmmaker today who makes a fantasy or a science fiction or a horror movie is influenced by The Zone, because I think Rod basically said, let's expand our imaginations. Let's go for the gusto. Let's do things that have never been done before. And, if you look at the world of 1959, science fiction was really not a respected genre. The fantasy and science fiction shows of the time were basically designed for the, quote-unquote, the kiddies. And, Rod gave it adult sensibility and dignity. And it was amazing. It became kind of must-see TV 40 years before that term, got its day.
Well, Stephen, you mentioned some of the, restraints that Rod had back in those days. Do you feel like maybe because of those restraints, the writing was better? Because nowadays it seems like, you could put just about anything on TV and it kind of makes it too easy, maybe.
I think that Rod had to make a conscious decision not to fight the Citadel anymore. It was just getting too difficult for him. So I think he decided that he would be a little clever. And his writing team, Rod didn't write all the episodes. It was also Richard Matheson and Charles Beaumont, George Clayton Johnson, Earl Hamner. And they took the gloves off, and with disguising stories with fantasy and science fiction, they were able to tell the stories of the human condition they couldn't tell in regular television. So I agree with you. The restrictions allowed them to turn it, just like a lot of the writers back in the 1940s and 50s and movies, with those very strict censor codes, were able to add a lot of innuendo that would get by the censors.
Well, I know you've spent a lot of time with The Twilight Zone. You mentioned working on it for about 3 years or so. Can you pick a favorite episode? Is there one you could point to that you enjoy the best?
Well, every time I put on a stop at Willoughby, it strikes a chord with me. That's the episode about the burnt-out advertising executive who takes the train home every night. It's a wintry scene. And one night he looks out the window, and it's all of a sudden morning, and it's a beautiful 1890s portrait of a small town with a band playing in the gazebo and kids with fishing poles. And then, of course, he wakes up, and he's back on that train dealing with frustrations. And I thought that struck a chord, not only with me, but a lot of people about nostalgia. And it reflects a lot how Rod felt about the modern world, that we all need a Willoughby to go back to, a time when things were less stressful. Our old hometowns, the places where we grew up, where we have that nostalgia feel. And that's something that's timeless. You could watch that show 100 years from now and really get what's going on. And there's another episode kind of like that from the first season called Walking Distance with Gig Young, where he's also a burnt-out advertising executive. I think Rod was so anti-advertiser at that time that every executive had to be a burnout case, but he goes back to his small town and actually goes through a time warp, and he's back in the 1930s, and that also struck a chord because he gets to see his parents who are living and himself as a little boy. There's something very nostalgic and poignant about those episodes.
I always enjoyed the one with Burgess Meredith, where he just wants time to read, and he finally has all the books in the world, and then loses his glasses. Yeah, when you watch these old episodes, you see all these actors you've seen in everything over the years, and they're so young, and it's great to just see that side of things as well.
I mean, Burgess Meredith was one of Rod's favorite people. He was in 4 episodes. He's very good. He's in an episode called The Obsolete Man, where he's a librarian in a totalitarian world where libraries are outlawed and people can't read books. So if you don't have a profession that works, they kill you. And it's a story of how he stands up to the power, and very powerful episode, very powerful. And then, of course, he got a little whimsical as the devil in the Printer's Devil episode, one of the 1 hours. And then he's the world's strongest man in another episode. And it's delightful to see actors like that getting to stretch themselves. And Rod really gave some great opportunities to him, people like Jack Klugman and William Shatner. Captain Kirk was in 2 of the greatest episodes. The one where he sees the creature on the wing still haunts us.
Definitely. Well, I wish we had more time, Stephen, but the Twilight Zone Encyclopedia is available now. Thank you so much for your time today.
Thank you so much.
And again, that was Stephen J. Rubin, author of the book The Twilight Zone Encyclopedia. It's available now.